Once more, greetings everyone, and welcome to the Afan Journal Club. So today, as you all know, one of our research fellows, Tunde, will be presenting an article. So as the tradition, so everyone will present him or herself. So I'll start by me. So I am Berjun Dokmotakut Singh, Financial Medical Student at the University of Buye in Cameroon, the Director of Operations of the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons. So on my screen here, Dr. Daniel, please, can you unmute your mic and present yourself?
Hello, everyone. I'm Dr. Daniel Safari from Democratic Republic of Congo. I'm a NEFAN Research Fellow and a junior lecturer at Official University of Bukavu. I work within the Department of Surgery at University Clinics of Bukavu and equally in the center, the Forensic Center at the same university as a research associate.
Thank you for your presence today, Dr. Daniel. Ginole, please, can you unmute your mic and present yourself?
Okay, hello everyone. I'm Ginole Ntefo, CDA medical student, University of Boya, Cameroon, and member of AFAN.
Thank you very much, Ginole, for your presence. Dr. Dokunu, can you please unmute your mic and present yourself?
Yeah, thank you, Dr. Berjo. I'm Dr. Dokunu Uyuk from Benin Republic, undergoing surgical training in Morocco. Thank you.
Thank you, too, Dr. Dokunu. Marwa, can you please unmute your mic and present yourself?
Good evening, everyone. I am Marwa Mohamed, Junior Doctor, University of Tripoli, Libya. Now I'm doing neurosurgery rotation postgraduate here.
Okay. Thank you very much for being with us today, Marwa. Musa Kanya, can you please unmute yourself and present yourself?
Hello, everyone. My name is Musa Kanya Shituruka from the Copper Belt University, Zambia, and I'm glad to be here.
Thank you very much. Olaoluwa, can you please unmute your mic and present yourself?
Greetings, everyone. I'm Olaoluwa Ezekiel Dada. I'm a second-year medical student at the University of Ibadan. I'm also the Director of Research at the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons. I'm glad to be here. Thank you.
Thank you very much for your presence. Umutoni, can you please unmute your mic and present yourself?
Hello, everyone. My name is Umutoni Alice, fourth year medical student from University of Rwanda. I'm glad to be here today. Thank you.
Thank you. Without waiting, so I'll give the floor to the presenter to present himself and start with the presentation. Thank you. So Tunde, you have the floor now.
All right. Thank you very much, Baju. Good evening, everyone. I am Tunde Olobatoke. I'm a 4th year medical student from the College of Medicine, University of Lagos. I'm also a research fellow of the Association of Future African Neurosurgeons. And today I will be presenting a review for the Journal Club meeting. So I'll be presenting the case titled Primary Angiomyoma in Cavernous Sinus, a case report. And the plan for this presentation is that first of all, we're going to look at a general overview, and then we'll review each section of the paper following this this order. So this is a general overview of the paper, and these are the authors, and it's a case report, like I mentioned, and it was published in 2015. So what we are going to be doing is I'll be giving everyone present to give comments as we go on, and then in the long run, I'll pass my comment as well. So, you know, to review this paper, we are going to follow the Web Science Academic Peer Review Guidelines. This is actually the peer review guidelines for that was released 2021. So we'll be following this guideline to review this paper. So, and these questions should be in our minds as we are reviewing each section. So these questions, as we're looking at the introduction, the case description, and all some of this question should be in your mind so that you'll be able to pass a very good constructive comment. Okay. So also we'll be following the CARE case report guidelines. Okay. And as we're reviewing each of them also, these questions should be in your mind. So I'll just leave this for a few minutes so that you can go through and familiarize yourself with it. All right. Okay, good. So looking at the introduction, like I said, we are going to start reviewing this paper by looking at the introduction. I believe that a number of us has gone through the paper before coming for this journal club meeting. So I would love some few people to just pass some comments and to say one or two things about the introduction of this paper. And if you look at the this side of the presentation, this question should actually be going through our minds right now. Is it clear what's already known about this case from this introduction? Is the research question or the aim, is it clearly outlined from this introduction? Is the report justified given what is already known about the topic? So I would love us to pass some few comments on this before we go on.
Okay. To answer the first question, I think what is known on the subject is quite well stated. Regarding the aim of the paper, the introduction doesn't much mention the aim of the paper. They just present the case without presenting the aim of the study. Yeah, I think the report is justified given what is known on the topic, as the procedure they applied in managing the case, to their understanding, it seems to be an innovation, as it's the first time this procedure is applied for such a case. Okay. I think there I'm done. Okay.
All right, Dr. Daniel, thank you very much. I don't know, does anyone want to pass any other comments? So looking at this paper, I feel Dr. Daniel, yeah, thank you very much for your comment. So yeah, first of all, I would say that the author were able to tell us what is known about the case already. But I feel it's not really, really complete looking at this introduction, because they said they only mentioned the fact that it's rare and the population that's usually affected, but they never mentioned about the treatment, which I feel there are articles already available about some of the widely used method of intervention, which I feel they could have mentioned here. So and if you look at this other statement, intracranial lesions are extremely rare. Approximately 13 cases have been reported to date, involving three cavernous sinuses. So I feel like I mentioned, they should have mentioned something like some of the past intervention that has been used. So I feel that could have been added here. Also, the aim of the research, well, it was not clearly stated, like Dr. Daniel mentioned, but the fact that it's a new case, since we are talking about it is a case report. So the fact that it's a new case, okay, so I feel that somehow but it the aim is actually not completely put out as it should. And we can say that this paper is justified, but like I mentioned, I feel there should be more information about what has been known, especially about the intervention that has been widely used in the past. And also I feel they could have also said something about the diagnosis that has also been used in the past. I know there are literatures available on this already. So I don't know, what do you think about that?
Yeah, can I?
Yeah, go on.
Yeah, I'm Dr. Yuki. Thank you guys for the comment you've made, been making on this introduction. I want to mention some certain things. You know, the first question is about to know if what is known, already known about the case, if it's clear enough. The question is not about if it's complete. The question is not to know when you are doing the review, when you are reviewing a paper, I mean, you're not sending a paper, you are doing the review, you have to answer those questions. Your job is not to find out if the author has said everything about the what is known about the case. No, it's no. What he has said, is it clear enough? I think, yeah, it's clear enough. It's clear. Because you guys are going towards giving much information. If in case the author will do that, he will go wrong. And the second question is, the word clear is coming again. Is the research question or aims clearly outlined? Is it clearly outlined? Is the question clearly, when you read the question, do you understand? I think yes, we understood the question. We understand what they are saying, what they want to do. That's the 2 points I want to add to what you are saying. If not, you'll be going very pretty well on the line. Okay, thank you. You go ahead.
A few comments also from my end.
Okay, go on.
Yeah, so that's it as regards your comments on the first part, also just to corroborate what has just been said. I feel this is quite sufficient owing to the fact that it's not a literature review. Okay, as much as it needs to, it would be nice if it details, if it adds all those information. Also, it's a case report. It's meant to be concise. Okay. Moreover, the condition in question, the paper says it's rare, so it's possible guidelines for its adequate treatment does not exist, and so it will be burdensome to expect him to start compiling treatment modalities which may or may not have been effective in those cases. Okay. Substandard items, so to speak. As much as there are just quite a number of factors to consider in this case. But in any case, I feel what he has for the first question, I feel it's adequate.
All right. Thank you very much for the input, Dr. Dokuno and Lord Armstrong. Thank you very much. Yeah, I agree with that. I agree with that. Thank you very much.
Hello. Hello.
Okay. I can hear you.
Thank you. Good evening to everybody, and thank you for letting me participate to this virtual session. Concerning the question you asked, the first question wants to know if it's clear what is already known about the case. I think we are faced to a relatively rare and very rare, I can say, case, because if you go on YouTube, you might not see topics concerning angioleomyoma in cavernous sinuses. Most of the topics on cavernous sinuses concerns thrombosis. So what is already known about this case, I think we know nothing yet. Concerning the second question, is the research question or aims clearly outlined? I think it is not clearly outlined in this paragraph you read all of us. And for the third question, is the report justified given what is already known about the topic? I think the answer is no. So that's the little contribution I Hello? Can give Hello? For now. Yes. Hello?
Yeah, Dr. Adrian, I think you are, I think you didn't get the procedure very well. What the author has to say in the introduction is a piece of paragraph to let anyone, even in those that is not in the neurosurgical field, to understand what it is about. When you say angioleiomyoma, what it is, what do we think about? That's what, and even if the person is an engineer and he read that paragraph, he has to understand. The question is not about to know if this specific case, you know, do we know much about this specific case before it's written? No. In fact, if you know much about the case before it's written, that means it's not, the case has nothing rare. Meanwhile, before, if you want to give more chance to your paper to be accepted in those journal, you know, you need to come up with something very rare, something unusual. That's these are two different things. I mean, the unusual aspect of the case, the rarity of the case, and what is known in the literature about the case. These are two, like angioleiomyoma, we know about it. If you go to Google and you tap, you write there angioleiomyoma, you read many things. You find out the thousands of things to read about that. So the first thing here, the first question here is about the angioleiomyoma.
Okay.
What the author has said, is it clear for us that we know what it means? Okay, he said it's a relatively rare soft tissue tumor that arises from the vascular smooth muscles. Okay, so that means this is something from soft tissue tumors, smooth muscles. Okay, so he gave us an insight about the case, but not about this specific case that he's writing about. We are not there yet. You see?
I'm not understanding the question like you. That's what I understand. Is it clear what is already known about this case? Which case are we talking about? Angela?
We are talking about the question you asked that way, but if you are, for example, you are a peer reviewer or you are an author, you are writing your case, make sure you answer that question, you will write about the case. Here, the question is about the angioleiomyoma. It's not about the unusual case being in cavernous sinus, because the unusual case here is having the angioleiomyoma in cavernous sinus. You see, that's the unusual case that the author brought up to make his paper publish. But the question here is mostly about what is known in general, angioleiomyoma. What do we know? That's it. As simple as it is.
All right.
Can I add something?
Okay. Just go on. You are very
famous. Okay. So, I understand. So it's just for like so that for the last session we don't lag behind time. It's for us to understand that when you're giving a case report, each journal has its requirements. And if actually you want to give all the details, it's better you do a literature review. So when it's a case report, usually they might say give it maybe 2,000 words, 1,000 words. So you have to be as concise as possible. And I think for the introduction, the person gave everything there. Maybe the way he presented it's not the best, but he gave everything. And as a reviewer, in fact, the most important aspect is a scientific component of the case, the other part, maybe a grammar, the English, or is not really that important compared to the scientific aspect. Thank you.
All right. Thank you everyone for the comment. So I think for the introduction, we are good to go, right?
Sure.
All right. Thank you everyone. Okay. So now, so let's look at the case description itself. So for this case description, as we look at the case description, all these questions, so this is the care guideline, okay? So this question should be running through our minds as we look at the case description. Okay, so looking at this case description, I would also love for one person to just quickly pass a comment on the case description.
About the case description.
Yes.
The water tried to talk about the age, the onset of symptoms, elicited about the symptom itself, and reading the first sentences, it's as if this was very sudden, like in 1 week history. And then he went on to talk about the radiographs. I think that maybe here maybe because it is it has to be submitted and they have word limits, but I would appreciate it more if he went more deep even beyond that 1 week, more beyond that 1 week that he is presenting about.
Okay, I don't get what you mean. Beyond that 1 week, can you clarify that? I don't really get that.
Because he's saying that the symptoms started in 1 week, right? The nausea, the intense nausea and vomiting for 1 week. Okay, I saw the daily headache and diplopia for 2 months. So I think that it is a really brief description. And that's it. I didn't read well the 2 months above. I think it's okay for now.
All right. Thank you very much. So so looking at the case description, I think the author did a good job by first of all outlining the main symptoms in this patient. Okay, so I think we're able to outline the main symptoms in this patient. The fact that he has headache and diplopia for 2 months. Okay, the main symptoms, the duration, was able to outline that very well. Okay, and he also was able to talk to us about the progression. He was able to illustrate the progression well, which is very, very key. The fact that he developed intense nausea, vomiting that lasted a week. So it was the headache, the diplopia, then the... So, but the, my concern here, my question here is, can we say that the author were able to maintain confidentiality? What can we say about the confidentiality here before I just pass my other comments?
Can I put a word there?
Yeah, go on.
Okay. I think the author respected the care guidelines regarding confidentiality here, as the patient is really identified. There is no name, there is no nothing related to the patient that can allows us to identify him. I mean, there he did a great job.
Yeah, good. Thank you. I think they did a good job. But I was thinking that this could have been better if the ethnicity were included. I don't know. What do you think about that? I feel that could probably point us towards the possibility of that being a risk factor. What do you think if the ethnicity could have been included? So I think in a bid of trying to maintain confidentiality, I don't know why I feel that could have been included.
Okay. Regarding the ethnicity, I don't see the importance to highlight the ethnicity or the ethnicity of the patient interested in this case. If it doesn't have any implication regarding the clinic or the clinical presentation or regarding the treatment required. I mean, if it doesn't add anything on the case, it's not necessary to highlight it.
Okay. Thank you very much.
According to me, the ethnicity is something important, because when we look at the epidemiology of certain diseases, they are more likely to occur in some particular group types and not in others. So concerning the epidemiology, it might be important, according to me.
Okay, for this case, is that important to highlight the ethnicity? Is the leiomyoma of the cavernous sinus interests certain ethnic group regarding to what is already known on the subject? Does it add something on the case important in order to be highlighted? If we do have a positive answer to that question, I mean, it is important that the ethnicity be highlighted in the case.
Hello.
Okay, yeah, but you go on.
So for the point of we are doing a review, anything that was important, if they did not mention that, then it means that for me, I don't think it's important. Like, we should not kind of assume that maybe for some diseases, because if actually the authors saw that it's important, the authors could have told us. So since they did not mention it, so I think we should not emphasize on that. For me, the case description is okay. Everything was mentioned there. The only thing that they didn't mention was the presumptive diagnosis, maybe before the investigations. But as I said, everything depends on the journal requirements. Thank you.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, everyone, for the comment. So, yeah. So let's just go on. So I could also see that they did not actually come up with a diagnosis before the investigation. But I feel that probably that's because it is very difficult to arrive at a diagnosis at this point. So probably maybe that should have been included. So the investigation were clearly outlined, okay? And they were clearly outlined, as I can see here, and but I don't know the rationale for the digital subtraction angiography. I don't know, should that be included? Because I can't see the rationale for digital subtraction angiography. And also I think the intervention that was preferred, that is a subtotal removal of the tumor. I think it's something they were able to indicate the fact that they never anticipated for that, because I think the plan was a total removal. So I think that the case description is okay. So can we just pass some comment on this, the imaging?
Sorry, but so what do we learn from the case report before coming to the imaging? Sorry, what do we learn? How do we write our case? Because we are here for each and everyone to learn something. How tomorrow if someone want to write his case, how will he go about it?
Okay, so let me just go over this again.
Let me just say it and say what I think, and we'll continue for you guys if you want. Because from what we've seen by reviewing cases and by writing, publishing, and all those things, what they've done is okay, as you already said, but it can be done in another way also. They put the patient age in this, the same signs and symptoms, and then go directly to the imaging. In this point, some authors can do it in a better way. And they put, after the age of the patient, they will put directly the major sign, the major complaint of the patient. Then, and add if the patient have some, because maybe if the patient has some a past medical history or not, you know. Because over here, they didn't put any past medical history. If you want, we can do it. So we need to have that in mind also. We can do it as they put it that way, like the age of the patient, and then signs and symptoms for the patient and what they find in the clinics. That's okay. But if you want, you can add to that, first paragraph, you can say the patient's past medical history is, or the patient past medical history is even remarkable, because there's no past medical history, nothing is there. Or you can mention it if it has something to do, if it can explain or it's connected with, or it has some link with the symptoms, okay? That's the only one what I want to add to all that you've said. Thank you.
All right, thank you, Dr. Mm-hmm.
About the image that you were showing, I don't know, but it could have been better for them to put some arrow to show the lesion, because what we are writing is for everybody, it's for everyone, and how they do it is okay. Anyone that is in surgery, we find a way to find the lesion, because they describe the lesion under the image. And so the only one thing, I will appreciate if I was the one reviewing the case, I would ask the authors to use arrows to indicate where are the lesions. That's the only one thing. If not, the images are clean and well exposed and all those things. So I will ask all of you to have an eye on something. You see that they put preoperative images. You know, the lesion is hyper intense lesion that is under the right side, right eye of the patient. Exactly, that's it. That's right. Lesion. Okay. So you see that they put the preoperative imaging, then the postoperative images, and then the arteriography, and then the images that they've got while doing the gamma knife. What I mean is, you have to make sure that the disposal of your images follow some logic. You know, even if while you are practicing, you've done a arteriography before doing MRI, when you are writing your case, you put the CT scan, you put the MRI, and then the arteriography, and then postoperative image. It follows some others the way it should be done. I don't know if you are getting what I'm saying. That's how it should be. That the way they do it is very nice. And okay. the third thing is that when you want to publish a paper, make sure you get the CD of the patient. Go to the colleagues that are in the radiology and ask them to copy the investigation on CD or on DVD for you. You take it to the computer and you will take out of it the correct and nice picture that you are seeing now. This image that they published, these are not images that are on that the radiology sent to us. You know, when the patient go and do those investigations, they will give the patient the result and some of the images that you can put and look at it and take picture or with your phone or something. Don't publish that. I've done it with two papers, and later I found out that they can accept it, but when you look at your paper, your work later, it's not so elegant. You know, it's not so good. So the best way for my own experience is that you go ahead. You go to the radiologist, you ask them to copy for you all the investigation that have been done, a CT scan, MRI, those that are in interventional radiology that have done the distal substrate angiography, you go and talk with them, catch them a little bit, discuss with them, you know, and then you ask them, they will help you. They will help you and they will copy it on CD. Once you put the CD on your computer, you will see it's very nice, and you will choose images on that. When you send that paper, they won't send the paper back for images are distorted or they are not clearly seen or all those things. Okay. Anyway, so that's what I want to say. And you can see they explain very well. They put down figure one and everything is explained under the figure. You can understand while reading, because you don't need to go back to the test to understand your figure and your tables. Please don't do that. When you write your case, you know, when you write your case, make sure your figure and your tables are understood on their own. Someone looking at this slide you are seeing, we don't need to go back to the test before understanding the table or the figure. Take that into account also. Okay, that, thank you.
Thank you very much, Dr. Dokone. Thank you
my
very
pleasure.
Much. Yeah, so just like it has been asked, so the imaging is well labeled, properly labeled. So probably the only thing that could have been done better here, just like Dr. Dokone has said, is to probably use an arrow to so that for those that are not inclined to images like this, they can easily identify the lesion. Okay, so this is just the some other images that were shown. This is the digital subtraction angiography. So one thing we should know about this is that the authors did a very good job outlining all the investigations that they carried out and the results of this investigation. So the pathologic findings also were highlighted, and I expect them actually to have to show how they actually arrived at the diagnosis, and I think they were able to do that from their pathologic findings. They were able to use the pathologic findings to rule out other possible differentials, like the schwannomas, the meningiomas. Exactly. They were able to rule that out. Mm-hmm. So another thing I could not see here, they didn't really talk about any challenges they faced during the course of the diagnosis. So, but I feel maybe they didn't face any. Maybe that was why it is not included. So if they had probably faced any, they would have. So especially in our areas where maybe you needed an MRI and you, maybe because the patient could not afford it, then you had to go. So all these things should have actually been included. But since they didn't include it, probably means that they did not really face any challenge. Okay, so they were also able to, the outcome of the procedure was also very well outlined. So after the first intervention, that is the partial, the subtotal removal of the tumor, and they gave reason for the subtotal removal of the tumor. So I think all these things, they actually did a very good job. Okay, so the outcome was also very outlined, like I mentioned.
Sorry for coming in, but what you are saying is very important. And they would have even come with that, you mean, a differential diagnosis is very important, because this lesion, what they described, they said the lesion is a hyperintense in T1, hyperintense in T2. A lesion that is hyperintense in T1 and hyperintense in T2, it might make you to think of meningioma. But now, yes, what's the differential diagnosis? In case you have if is the lesion highly enhanced after the injection of gadolinium of the contrast? Product of contrast, yes. If yes, that means it's more likely to be a meningioma. But in this their case, I don't know what they explain. What do they say about the enhancement? Can we find it somewhere? Is the lesion enhanced with the injection of gadolinium?
No, they didn't mention that here.
Yeah. They mentioned it. I've seen it somewhere now within the case just some time ago. They mentioned somewhere that the lesion wasn't enhanced and it was heterogeneously enhanced. Yeah. Lesion was heterogeneously enhanced. That's what they said. You know, you see, so if it was a meningioma, it would have been highly enhanced. When you, because this, that you are talking about is very important. And yeah, it's annoying when the editor have to send you, or the associate editor have to send you back the case, like, you know, this part is not well discussed. You have to discuss this part, like to discuss a little bit the differential diagnosis with other cases. This is your case, when you see the imaging, I mean, what kind of lesion can be confusing with that? So you have to mention it. It takes only two sentences to mention that, and you go ahead with that, with it. So please, when you're writing your case, be specific. Check your lesions in the imaging, like what other lesions that are looking like that lesion, because you find out that the symptomatologies are not specific. For you to say, okay, when the patient coming with this and this and that, for sure, this is the diagnosis, no. So when you have the imaging, so what other lesion that you can, what other diagnosis you can think of? So you take only two sentences to discuss that, if you don't mind, and I think your case will be okay. Sorry for coming in that way. I don't know if it's okay.
Yeah, it's okay. Thank you very much. Okay. So yeah, so just like Dr. Dokone said, okay, so if there's any differential, you should be able to rule that out. and to come up with your own with your diagnosis. So also, like I mentioned, the outcome was clearly stated, and they also stated the reason for the change in their intervention. I think they were actually planning a total removal before, so they stated the reason for that, which is very important. And also, they also show the dosage of the dosage of the radio surgery that was used. So this is very important. And if it's also to be drug, it should be clearly stated the dosage that was used. And so a total of about 22.5. So I think they did a great job, okay, by highlighting the outcome, the dosage of the second intervention, which is the radio surgery, the cyber knife, okay. And so this is the histology finding. So and I also think the imaging is fine, right? Do we agree with that, or is there anything that we feel should have been done better?
I think it's okay. We can find better than that. That's beautiful. Very nice. Right. Well done. Yeah.
So yeah. So like you mentioned, okay. Who's any comments?
Yeah, no. You can go ahead. That is great. The immunohistochemistry imaging. So go to the post treatment, my.
So yeah, the post op follow up of the patient, the test carried out, and the results were also clearly outlined. So I think they also actually did a great job as well by outlining the test and the results. So, this just to show this the CyberKnife treatment planning for the residual, and I think they actually did a great job outlining how it was done and the imaging. So also, like I mentioned, the follow-up was also clearly outlined. So I think they did a great job. I don't know if there's any other way this could have been done better, because they showed the results. There's an update at every point during the follow-up. So the outcome of the second intervention, which is the cyber knife reduced surgery, the outcome was stated with test results that were done. So I think they did a great job with that. So this is a post-treatment MRI with contrast. So yeah, so I think we just go to this. So I think are we good with the case description?
Yeah, but you skip one place of the case that the colleagues need to know about, need to be aware of pretty well. I mean, the place where they describe the surgery. There's a paragraph where the what have been done in the operative theater have been described very well. You didn't talk about that. Could you please go up a little bit again? One more.
Tunde, go to the first slide of the case description. You have that there. Yeah, there's it.
Exactly. Yeah. So this we didn't talk. This place is very important. That everyone should be aware of. Don't write your case and just say the patient have been operated or the patient that went surgery and that's it. No. Because the reviewer or the editor will want to know what has been done. You guys should see how it has been described. It said a right frontotemporal craniotomy was performed. The tumor blood supply was reached. The tumor had clear boundaries, a tough hard texture, and was located within the cavernous sinus. You see, it's well described. It's showing that this person he know what he's talking about, and even I don't know if he was there when the case was operated, but. When you are reading a case and you are reviewing a case and you read that, you are okay with that kind of photo. It's very important to mention it. Don't just say, okay, the patient that went surgery and the lesion was removed or the lesion was gross totally resected. That's kind of one phrase that you throw in the air. That is not too scientific. So please, guys, when you're writing your case, make sure you describe what have been done during the operation, right frontotemporal craniotomy. Anyone that is in surgery or no surgery that read that, you know what you're talking about. That's what I want to add to all those things before coming to the discussion.
And,
Thank you.
And Also, I would like to add that it is very important to see why they stop the resection, why they do two stage to perform first time surgery and go after to complete it by CyberKnife. So it is very important also to highlight that in your review. It is important you will see that this tumor was located also around the cavernous sinus, and all of us we know very well what kind of structure we have in cavernous sinus.
Yeah.
So that is why they try to carefully separate it and then achieve a subtotal removal because of attachment of with ICA. Nobody want to touch ICA in their procedure because you will let your patient on the table. Thank you very much, guys.
Exactly.
Yeah. Thank you very much for the input. Thank you very much for the input. So, and I think
we were at the discussion level, right?
So because of our time, if you can have like one person to pass a comment first, then I'll pass my comment and then we move on from there.
Why others are not talking? This is an exchange to learn and to, you have to discuss to learn. If you are not talking, you keep quiet. I don't know.
I think the discussion is well written. The first paragraph must highlight what we present in the case, and in that for that case report, the author begin by referring to the case reported. He goes so far comparing his case to other case described with the same lesion. So he also compare clinical examination, pathological examination, pathological results he got from his patient to the result of other patients and other published cases. So the case was well discussed.
Yeah, I think also, I think they go, they focus on, it is well discussed. But it is just this slide you have about discussion.
The discussion is more than this. We have, let me just.
Okay.
Yeah, so they discuss the imaging, they discuss the pathology.
That is very.
Discuss the treatment and.
Even if I should do the same things, I think I will go like that also. Also they exactly this DSA characteristic is very important also because sincerely, it is a low surgeon neurosurgeon to know exactly with precision where you are going and what you should avoid. Sometimes in MRI, it is not so clear to carry out every vascular structure that around or inside the tumor. It is very nice what they did here.
Thank you very much. So I think
you want to have anything to say again or to want to discuss or to want to know about this condition. I don't know, before to go to conclusion. I don't know if Dr. Yug, you have any comment again to add. In my opinion, I think it is well written.
No, it's okay. The case is well written, and I will just ask the panel to take a time, look at the case. Look at the case that have been reported, they put the patient's age, the signs and symptoms, and then some paragraphs. When you look at the disposal of the paragraph, it's the same way they follow to discuss, to talk about.
Exactly.
You will see, the case.
That organization.
That makes sense.
Exactly. The way they put the paragraph on in the reported case, the symptoms and location, all those things, and then talk about the imaging, and that's how they follow to do the discussion. If you look at it very well, that will help also to know that, okay, things are not done just that way. It's done sort of following some kind of order, you know.
Yeah.
That's just what I want to add to that. Anyway, the discussion is okay.
Great.
So there are some other authors that will even put down some questions in the introduction, like, you know, they will review the case and with cases in the literature. And the first paragraph of the discussion, we talk about that at first. It depends on how you want to write your case anyway.
Yeah.
Thank you very much for the input. So yeah, overall, I think the discussion is good. They were able to cite very good literature to compare their findings with what is already known about the case. And also this new DSA characteristic they were able to show. So they were able to highlight, and I think the organization is very, very okay. So they discuss each segment, the imaging, the pathology, the treatment. So I think the discussion is okay. Okay. So I think, are we good with the discussion?
Yeah, it is okay for me.
Let's look at the conclusion. What do we have to say about this conclusion?
They carry out the key findings, and it is okay for me. They conclude very well what they did and what they find in literature. Yeah, it is good.
Yeah.
I hope that in our country we will have immunohistochemy, because that is, however, that is another discussion. But it's very good to know that, because all these parameters is very helpful on the management and to have an idea for prognosis of the patient. But it's very, very great. So,
anyway, for the overall picture, just try to look at what I said previously about the case reported. You know, that's the same thing they did for the conclusion. You know, in the discussion, you know, has the case has been reported. You see, when you look at the case that have been reported, case description, the history, then the pathology finding, then the saber knife, then the postoperative cost. In the discussion, that's the same way they did. They talk about the case and then the imaging, pathological finding. Then they discuss the surgery, discuss the gamma knife treatment that have never been done before, and they discuss the postoperative period of the patient. In the conclusion, same way, they put the case, the diagnosis, the treatment, the saber knife treatment, and the prognosis. You know, so those four or five lines that they follow, you know, I think it's okay. They've done a great job anyway. But for us, we need is very important for us to look at it that way, so that we could learn and know how to go about those things. Because the major problem is that when you are not used to writing those cases, and you want to do it for the first time, or you are making your first step in this field, you'll be confused about how to go about it and where to start from, and how to follow your ideas, you know. And I think that is why these sessions are very important for all those that want to get in, you know. So we need to bring out the scheme that the authors are following to write their cases. There are many of them. There's not only one style. There are different type of styles, but at each step, we need to bring out the scheme that they've been following, the backbone that they've been following by writing their cases. And this will help us to, do the same if we want to write something good anyway. Thank you, guys.
I'm totally agree with you. And what I want also to add, it is this thing always have in mind when one writes a case about surgery cases. Always have in your mind of the clinical presentation, the diagnosis assessment, the management. The management could be medical, surgical
or
some planning before to manage. However, you can depend how you manage your patient. You should depend on the management, and then the outcome, and then the follow-up. And the last five paper that I reviewed for interdisciplinary neurosurgery, I recommended this structure for them, and they carefully do it this way, and the paper was the paper is published. was published at the last issue in Interdisciplinary Neurosurgery. So always this structure, you should be have your structure of your case report in your mind, and also to discuss in the same way your findings, and to conclude what you find also in, at the end between your case and the, and your literature review to discuss.
So I think the references are okay. They were able to cite the latest. The relevant document about the relevant papers about
that is great references also
authors, many journals require that your references should be less than 10 years.
Yes, but I see that one of the references, one or two, I think 1990.
Yeah, just very few.
In case otherwise, I mean, the paper is very important for your case, and it's one of 15, 20 years, is okay. But most of the references should be less than 10 years, the majority of the references should be less than 10 years.
Yeah, I think that case where the year is kind of far behind, I'm sure the author was kind of highlighting maybe the first time the case was noticed.
You can do that when the paper is very important for the case.
But most of the
papers to be less than 10 years. You can have some papers that are published even 30 years back or 40 years back. That's okay. But if you have like 10, if you have like 20 references and 18 or 17, 15 or 18 are recent within 10 years, and you have two or three that are more than 10 years, it's okay. That's no problem.
Yeah, I think that's okay. That's fine. Thank you very much.
I think that's what they've done, and the references are okay.
Yes. So now looking at all this, what do we think about the title of this article? Could it have been better than this, or it's just fine?
No, it is fine. It is very simple. It's fine for me. They don't. It is fine.
Yeah, and the case report that they included is I think
they just on the case report, so that is a very good.
Yeah,
they can even say case report in literature review if they want, because they've reviewed a lot of literatures.
I think they don't want to go, you know, but also sometimes they can ask you to
make a table.
Exactly.
Yeah, exactly.
So
it's more work.
Case report.
Yes. So I think it's nice what they do. Yeah.
All right. So now we review the abstract finally. So looking at the abstract, well, I feel they were able to summarize everything that has been written in the paper. But I don't know, I feel if you look at this, they were able to show what the case actually added to the to what's already known about the paper. But on that thing, they were able to also state the main symptoms, which is very, very important. They were able to show the main diagnosis, the intracranial angiomyoma. But one thing I'm looking at is they show just MRI. I don't know, should they have included the fact that they were able to actually arrive at the diagnosis because of the histology they did? So I feel, maybe that should have been included in the abstract. The fact that they were able to arrive at the diagnosis, because so just MRI, resonance imaging review, the large tumor located in the right cavernous sinus, and it was treated subtotally. So I don't know, I feel that reading that could just show maybe it was just MRI that made them to come through about the diagnosis. So they show the main investigation, but not all the investigation, like I said. They were able to show the intervention. But I don't know the outcome. I don't feel the outcome was clearly outlined. So I would just want us to pass our comments. What do we think about the abstract?
Yeah,
of this case.
Yeah, you can see that all the questions you've asked got their answers in this short paragraph, right? This is wonderful. I wish I could write this way. I want to, because this is wonderful. This is very nice. They've done a great job. The only one credit I'm giving to what you to your comment is the outcome, the prognosis. I mean, they didn't talk about the patient at the end. I mean, when they've done the surgery, they've done the gamma knife, the lesion has decreased in size. That's okay. But what about the patient? Has the diplopia reduced? I mean, has it subsided? We don't know. Has the headache subsided? These are the two things that need to be in the abstract, at the end of the abstract. If not, everything is okay. They've answered all the questions about abstract, the case, the investigation that have been done, the main symptoms, the diagnosis, the surgery, the gamma knife, subtotalization, gamma knife, followed by gamma knife. And then the tumor has reduced in size after 20 months. But the only one thing that is lacking in this abstract, because the abstract is the window of your paper. When someone reads the abstract, you need to want to know more, you know? So the only one that is lacking in this abstract, it should be only one sentence at the end to mention that, okay, well, after all this thing have been done, the patient is doing well, or the patient, the headache and diplopia have subsided. You know, that's only one. That can be added to it. Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Defino. Any other comments?
Tunde, I think you can go ahead because you have already mentioned everything in the abstract.
All right. So so to conclude this paper, I don't know, maybe the I don't know if they were able to actually conclude very well, but I feel the conclusion could have been better. So let's give an overall conclusion as we round up with the journal meeting tonight. So overall, can we say this paper is important, promising, improve, better overall, and is there any need to do more research based on this paper? And would this affect your practice in any way? Because the goal is not is to, the goal of this journal meeting, just like Dr. Defino says, so I just want someone, one person to just pass a comment on this as you round up. Thank you very much. Okay.
So for the first point, the paper is very important. Yeah, it's very important simply because it actually mentions a rare case, a case that usually doesn't occur in the intracranial space, but for this patient, it occurred. And also, it will help us to have other differential diagnoses, as Dr. Dopuno mentioned earlier, like on the with the MRI findings, whereby you could think of a meningioma. So for me, that is the reason it's important. Like you make us have at the back of our mind this diagnosis. We'll see what publishing is published. It has been published, and I think it was actually what publishing since a rare case, and also the intervention done to manage a patient. So how could it have been improved overall? For me, it was almost perfect. So I don't really think there's much to add, because for me, everything was clear in his case report, except for the minor comment that we did. Is there need to do more research? Well, maybe on other treatment modalities, maybe to have, maybe to see if other treatment modalities have better outcomes. Yeah. And definitely it will affect the practice. Following from the first point I mentioned, you have in mind this type of tumor, then you will definitely have it as a different diagnosis for a patient who presents to you with features of risk jacquinal pressure, as this patient presented with. Thank you.
Thank you, everyone, for the comments. You actually made this presentation worth attending. Thank you very much.
Yeah, so I also want to thank everyone who attended this meeting, especially Dr. Dokuno, Dr. Nuru, for their incredible comments and tips on how to write a case report in neurosurgery. So I just hope that everyone that is here or those who watch the recording will actually be able to, you know, make constructive case reports, which will at least help us to improve the research items in neurosurgery. Thank you very much.